One of the main reasons genealogists use DNA is to match with cousins. And in the last couple of years, as millions of more people have tested their DNA, the number of cousins that people match with has exploded. So the question is, are all these thousands of people worth researching? Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, and this is a segment of DNA. Be sure to subscribe to our channel and click on the bell if you'd like to be notified about upcoming episodes. Cousins, cousins, and more cousins. I remember when I first took a DNA test. I was really excited when 23andMe was showing that I had more than 600 cousins that I matched with. Now that number slowly crept up as more and more people tested. And when I reached 1,000, I was ecstatic. As I've tested with other companies, I've added to the total number of cousins that I share some little bit of DNA with. So where do my matches stand at the end of 2018? Well, I have more than 33,000 matches on Ancestry. I have over 1,400 matches on 23andMe, more than 6,000 matches on MyHeritage, over 3,000 matches on FamilyTreeDNA, and GEDmatch gives you the first 2,000 matches free. So that's a lot of matches. Based on these numbers, it looks like Ancestry should be the best database because it gives you the most matches. And next is MyHeritage, and then FamilyTreeDNA, and then GEDmatch, and finally 23andMe. But is this really the case? Not all matches are created equal, and not every company reports matches in the same way. First off, there is a matching threshold, and by this I mean there is some amount of DNA you must share with somebody before the company will call that a match. Now this minimum amount is different for each company, but if you go to your match list and go to the very last match in that, you can find out what their minimum is. For Ancestry and 23andMe, it's 6 centimorgans. For MyHeritage, it's 8 centimorgans. For FamilyTreeDNA, it's 13 centimorgans. And for GEDmatch, my 2000th match has 10.5 centimorgans that's shared with me. And with this, we come to our first problem. There's been a lot of research about small shared segments and whether or not they indicate an actual relationship or they're just a false match because people from different groups all share a lot of the similar DNA, especially when you break it down into very small segments. Now, somewhere between 7 and 10 centimorgans, the number of matches that are false matches exceeds the number of real matches. To simplify that, for every 2 matches that you share 10 centimorgans or less then, one of them is not related to you, and maybe both of them aren't related to you. And unless you research them all, there's no way to tell which ones are false matches and which ones are real matches. So this would indicate that a significant amount of matches at Ancestry, 23andMe, and MyHeritage may not be related to me. The second problem with all of those thousands of matches is how many of them are what I call quality matches. What I mean by a quality match is a match that you have a reasonable probability of actually identifying a recent common ancestor with. Now, based on my personal experience and working with clients' matches, I peg this value at around 35 centimorgans or more. Now that doesn't mean that you're not going to be able to find a recent common ancestor for a match that is less than 35 centimorgans. It just means that the chances of that happening start to decrease dramatically the smaller the amount of shared DNA we have. For my data at each of the testing companies, I broke out the number of quality matches I had and further divided that up into bands of shared DNA. I left out all of my close relatives, that would be any first cousins or closer, and I also didn't include any people that I specifically had asked to test to help confirm a relationship. So as you can see from this chart, instead of 33,000 matches at Ancestry, I have 188 quality matches. That's a lot more manageable in trying to figure out how I'm related to all of them, but it's still a lot, and I'm probably not gonna get to all 188 of them. The only outlier in this table, as you can see, is FamilyTreeDNA. Now, even though they gave me more than 3,200 matches, more than 1,200 of those were quality matches, which is a much higher number than any of the other companies. Family tree DNA also had the highest threshold of about 13 centimorgans that they were reporting as a match. Which brings us to our third problem in looking at our match list. While we may share 13 centimorgans with a match, how that 13 centimorgans is divided up can help tell us whether or not it's likely a false match. For instance, if we share 13 centimorgans in one long segment with a match, that's likely somebody that we're related to, although pretty distantly. Now, if that 13 centimorgans is divided up into two or more segments, all of which are less than 10 centimorgans or even less than 5 centimorgans, then it's likely that that may be a false match. And we just share DNA with them from coincidence of being from the same broad group. Now, this problem is eliminated by the other testing companies by removing any segments that are less than 5 to 10 centimorgans. Family tree DNA adds all of these little segments into the total, which inflates the total number of quality matches. Now, in another video, I will show you how you can correct this, but these are my corrected numbers of my quality matches from Family Tree DNA. And these numbers seem more in line with what the other companies are reporting. Next, let me introduce a comparison number so that we can compare these companies side by side, even though they have different sizes of databases. By dividing the number of quality matches by the size of the database in millions, I get a QM over M score. Now you can see that the four testing companies all have a QM over M score clustered around 16 to 19. GenMatch's QM over M score is a lot lower, and I would guess that's because they have a higher threshold for identifying matches. So they don't give you as many matches based on the size of the database that you would expect from the testing companies. You can see that the QM over M score for the unadjusted family tree DNA values was 40 times the next closest value, which is why adjusting for these small segments is appropriate. Finally, I looked at the total number of matches compared to the database size, or TM over M. Interestingly enough, there's some nice data to analyze here. First off, Ancestry and MyHeritage have very similar TM over M scores, which tells me that their algorithms are about equal as far as identifying matches based on their data. GenMatch is about half as much as Ancestry and MyHeritage, which probably reflects the higher thresholds that they use in matching. The really interesting ones, though, are 23andMe and FamilyTree DNA. Let's look at FamilyTree DNA first. Because of the smaller number, the threshold that FamilyTree DNA uses to match individuals together must be more stringent than what Ancestry and MyHeritage use, but it's not as stringent as what GenMatch uses. 23andMe is the big outlier. Their TM over M score is just 10% of what Ancestry or MyHeritage is. Now, there are two reasons that I can think of for this. One, their thresholds must be more stringent. But at the same time, it doesn't significantly sacrifice the ability to identify quality matches. Because their QM over M score, while less than MyHeritage and Ancestry, is still in the same ballpark as those two values. Second, 23andMe has you opt in if you want to participate in the DNA relatives, and not everybody has. They say they have a database of 5 million people, but maybe only half of them have actually opted in to the DNA relatives. Now, all other things being equal, if this is the driver for the lower TM over M score, then you would also expect the QM over M score to be much less. But in fact, the QM over M score is right in line with what the other companies have. So let's quickly look and see what, if only 3 million people opted in, would look like on their numbers. The TM over M score is still significantly less than what it is for Ancestry or Family Tree DNA or MyHeritage. But the QM over M score is now much higher than what it is at the other companies, because all those quality matches were found with a smaller database. If we go down to only 1 million of their customers opting in, then we see that the TM over M score is in line with what some of the other companies have. But now that QM over M score is much, much greater than what you see at any of the other companies. For Family Tree DNA, we had to correct for the smaller segments because of how many matches they were showing based on the size of their database. However, 23andMe doesn't include all those small matches as part of their reporting, so there's no need for correction. Basically, what I conclude from all of this is two things. First, I think 23andMe has the best matching algorithm, followed by GEDmatch. What this means is that if all of the databases grew by 1 million more names, you would find more quality matches from 23andMe and from GEDmatch than you would from the other databases. Second, and probably more important, all of the company's algorithms are sufficiently robust to give you plenty of quality matches. With the total number of quality matches that I've identified, I don't expect to be able to research and identify how I'm related to all of them. And as more and more people test, the number of quality matches you have is going to continue to increase. I'll leave a link to the spreadsheet in the description below so that if you want to calculate your QM over M score and your TM over M score at the different companies, then you can do that. If you have any questions, put them in the comments below. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and be sure to tell your friends about it.